people, I would like to tell you something about myself. I am Gerard van Rhenen. In English, Gerard van Rhenen. I am 76 years old and I live in the north of the Netherlands. In the past, at our home, in my parental home, there was a harmonium. From childhood, I played on it and taught myself to read notes. I played all kinds of things, chorales and songs, but also arrangements for harmonium of overtures, marches, arias from operas, and of course Bach, preferably the pieces from his keyboard books for Wilhelm Friedemann and Anna Magdalena. From the age of 18, I received organ lessons from our village organist. He was a professional and had studied at the conservatory. I really wanted that too, to study at the conservatory. 3 years later, when I was 21, I was at the conservatory in Utrecht, where I obtained the organ and piano diploma. Later, I also studied harpsichord and fortepiano in Amsterdam and The Hague. I also obtained diplomas for those instruments. And finally, I also obtained a master's degree in musicology at Utrecht University. So, I was completely self-taught until I was 18. When I studied organ and piano in Utrecht, I was one of the first to purchase Talma's book and eagerly read it through several times as if it were an exciting novel. I felt his research and its results confirmed my idea that performing musicians were playing too fast. In any case, I couldn't keep up with their pace and I didn't like that fast playing either. I now think these two were related. I didn't like too fast playing because I couldn't do it myself. In retrospect, that is actually very human. I was never really a fanatic follower of Talma's ideas. That's not my nature, fanaticism. I didn't play everything in double beat, but took my own tempo, also at my concerts. Usually they were a bit slower than most concert givers did. I did attend a few lectures by Talma in the 1980s, in which he explained his findings and showed how the half-tempo sounds on organ and clavichord. I loved it, mainly because of his enthusiastic and inspiring words and playing. In 2010, Lorenz Gradient's book Takt und Pendelschlag was published. He wanted to revive Talma's findings and of course hoped for more success than Talma. Both Talma and Gradient have failed to convince the music world that they are right. Before the book by Talma, an earlier book by Erik Schwandt had already been published in 1975 with the title Music and Dance from the court of Louis XIV. Louis XIV. However, his research was limited to French Baroque court dances and the writings of Michel Lafilaire, in which tempo prescriptions by means of pendulum markings, but also interesting. However, his research was limited to French Baroque court dances and the writings of Michel Lafilaire, in which tempo prescriptions by means of pendulum markings. After reading Gadienne's book, the old fire came back to me. In the meantime, Facebook and YouTube existed, and I eagerly put my ideas about the earlier tempi in all kinds of messages on Facebook, and posted music played by myself in double beat on YouTube. Of course, I received many responses. Apparently, the tempo problem was a problem among many musicians, but almost all responses were negative. Hardly anyone wanted to share my enthusiasm about double beat, until Wim Winters appeared on the Facebook stage. He was also very interested and asked me about Gadienne's book. I gave him Gadienne's email address, and then we both were on Facebook with his comments on tempo. We alone against a huge group of opponents. At one point, Wim could no longer stand all that negative criticism and started his own YouTube channel, Authentic Sound. There, he turned out to be a fanatical follower of Talsma's and Gadienne's ideas, much more fanatical than I had ever been. When he started playing Beethoven sonatas at half the tempo of Czerny, and later also Alberto, he did it on YouTube, I could no longer believe in his ideas of his way too slow playing of Beethoven, especially the slow movements. And from then I started to criticize his view. He couldn't bear that and banned me from his channel. Apparently, he couldn't stand the fact that his former companion had turned on him. I thought that was a shame, because I wanted to have my own say. And that's why I am now here on my own YouTube channel. There is another person who wrote on tempo. That is Grete Wehmeyer. She wrote a book about Carl Czerny and a book with the title Prestissimo. It is a pity that the books by Talsma, Wehmeyer and Gadienne are written in German. So all who don't know German should get the information from Wim Winters. Fortunately, that will soon change, because there will be an extensive translation of the book of Gadienne. I just want to talk a little more about the two books which are about tempo by Grete Wehmeyer. The book Carl Czerny appeared in 1983, 3 years after the publication of Talma's book. In that book, she shows her conviction that nowadays people play too fast. So fast that people no longer understand the essence of the music. But she does not go as far as Talsma and Guardian, who claim that they played much slower, half as fast with the past. She places Czerny, who the book is about, in his own time, in his own culture. About the lessons Czerny received as a child from his father, who was also a piano teacher, Czerny writes the following in his Erinnerungen, his memories. Since my father had acquired a very good playing style and correct handling of the fortepiano by studying the Bachsen, Clementische and similar works, this had a positive influence on my diligence, as I carefully removed from other children and always under my eyes' parents stayed. So it became a habit for me to work hard. The word diligence became the most important word in his life. From his father, he learned that diligence was the most important virtue. He also learned from his father that he had to study for 6 hours every day. From the age of 15, he started teaching himself. He himself says about this in his Erinnerungen, his memories. I was about 15 years old when I started teaching myself. Soon all hours of the day were occupied, so I could raise my price, because I naturally brought everything I acquired to my parents, as I was used to through my upbringing, everything to receive from my parents what we needed to live. Our domestic conditions soon began to improve, and this spurred my diligence, to which my father also added his, in order to gradually secure a comfortable future for us. Czerny had started out as a child prodigy and was taught by his unrelenting father, who was himself a piano teacher. He studied 6 hours a day and regularly gave concerts with noble and wealthy families in Vienna. So he must have already had an incredible technique as a child. Then, at the age of 27, he receives a request from Beethoven to play his piano concerto in E-flat major in the great Redoutenhall in Vienna during a concert for the elite of Vienna. He hesitates and gives Beethoven the following answer. In order to perform as a virtuoso, I need at least 3 months to fully practice my playing technique again. The great piano players of our time sacrifice their health and their whole existence to this end, and feel happy when they then satisfy the criticism to some extent. In the end, he decides to do it anyway, this to serve his former teacher and the high arts. It was therefore his last public appearance. He retired to his study and then led a secluded life. He filled his life with teaching, composing and writing, day after day, because the word diligence was the most important word to him. What he expects from his students, and especially from his talented students, he writes down in his Piano Method Opus 500 and elaborates in his major and most important etude books, such as School of Velocity, School of Dexterity, School of Virtuosity, School for the Left Hand, the 40 Daily Exercises, the School of Staccato and Legato, the School of Octaves, the School of Embellishments, etc. Moreover, he has them study technical exercises that have to be repeated 10, 15, 20, yes, even 30 times. He was not alone in this. In the many schools written in the 19th century, students were advised to practice many hours a day, not only performing pieces, but also and above all technique, in order to master as much speed as possible. That was the culture in Czerny's time. Grete Wehmeyer says about this, the first composition of the young Czerny appeared in print around the same time. As a 15-year-old boy, he already had a very busy life. He himself says about this in his Erinnerungen, his memories. At that time, I usually gave 11 to 12 lessons daily, from 8 in the morning to 8 in the evening, and taught to the highest nobility and the first families of Vienna. This was a lucrative, but also extremely strenuous and health-demanding occupation. It was more than 20 years until I gave up teaching altogether. Regardless of this exhausting daily occupation, I still composed in every free minute, especially in the evening, and tried most of the subjects without missing any of my numerous lessons. I used all the evening lessons for composing. And Greta Wehmeyer says, at Czerny's pianoforte school, he recommends playing all 24 scales for 1 hour a day. And in the foreword to the 40 daily exercises, he says, nothing is more important for the performing artist than to practice the most charitable difficulties undauntedly, so often until he has mastered them completely. Current studies only have this purpose. And if the player of them, after the prescribed repetitions, and after he has practiced them completely, daily, with the Meltzel metronome, in the indicated time, his fingers will not miss the ability to bring out everything conceivable with certainty. And Greta Wehmeyer asked herself, the question remains, which goal one serves for that? It was hardly about rehearsing new pieces. It was, and is, mainly about dexterity, about bravado and brilliance in the sense of Czerny's, about speed and consistency. Greta Wehmeyer says about the preparation for the virtuoso career that the young Franz Liszt wanted to undergo after hearing Paganini play, Czerny's student Franz Liszt must have practiced similarly in Paris when he wanted to transfer Paganini's virtuosity to the piano, with jumps, fingering, passages, 10, 20, 50 times each, and that for 5 to 6 hours a day for 3 years. This is how he had learned it from Czerny. Czerny's conception of practicing and training on the instrument made school and is largely still practiced today. It reflected then and still does today the work philosophy. Greta Wehmeyer thus acknowledges in her book that in the 19th century, at least at the time of Czerny, there was a period of virtuosity. That was the fashion with the public and therefore also with the players, because they get their money from them. Czerny's MM numbers were geared to this, and so were those of his fellow composers. If you want to participate in the prevailing culture as an artist, you have to submit to it for the sake of many. That was at least the case during the period in which Czerny lived, and still is today. I ask you, why did the dodecaphonic composers of the first half of the 20th century give up? Because they wanted to stop doing it themselves? No, because the public did not appreciate their works. Next question. Why do many musicians play today fast? Faster than necessary? Precisely, because the jury members of competitions, the directors of the concert halls, the programmers at radio and TV, the producers of CDs, etc., want to, yes, even demand it. Mrs. Wehmeyer saw that correctly. In the 19th century, there was no such thing as double beat or whole beat. No, fast playing was a culture. And once one has experienced such a culture, there is no going back. Fast playing was the culture and stayed the culture until now. Yes, there were some people from the end of the 19th century who criticized the speed of the virtuosos and found the MM numbers of most composers too fast. Some editions of Czerny's etudes got slower MM numbers. But the current way of playing remained the same, albeit that the sharp edges went off. In general, people played slower than the MM numbers dictated. This under the motto, "The soup is never eaten as hot as it is served." So again, the MM marks never have been halved. We will have to accept that there was a period of virtuosity, of which Czerny, Liszt, Paganini, Moscheles, Chopin, and also Beethoven, yes, also Beethoven, were part of. They recorded their MM numbers for the purpose of, well, yes, fill in yourself. I already said that. If you want to play slower than the MM numbers indicated, go ahead. You can even play at half tempo. But don't say that was the tempo from the time of Czerny. Double beat never existed. It was invented to find a solution to the unease that we can to feel at the speed of the music in the second half of the 20th century. Greta Wehmeyer saw that correctly. But even after reading Talsma's book, she still believed in her own view of the matter, and that is, we still live in that age of virtuosity. We have to try to get out to really enjoy the music again. I myself recommend her book on Carl Czerny. Too bad there is no English translation. Bye bye.